What does that word mean? Well, in New Jersey, it can mean anything you think is unusual about where you live, who you encounter, or the stories you've been told. Weird New Jersey is the unofficial travel guide to everything you won't find on state-funded sightseeing maps. Unexplored backroads, neglected history, fabled places, the resident crazy down the block, anything that adds to our state's odd flavor and a culture that is uniquely New Jersey's. With camera and notebook in hand, intrepid Weird New Jersey publishers Mark Skuerman and Mark Moran have traversed the state, seeking out New Jersey's oddities and local legends. One can only imagine the countless tales yet to be told about the people and places right in our own backyard. Join us now as we explore some of the roads less traveled that can only be found right here in Weird New Jersey.
Seems a tad muddy, Moran.
I didn't warn you. Just told everyone to wear their boots. Nobody listened.
Ow! Just got whipped in the eye.
Not your eye.
There it is. The first stop on the Weird New Jersey tour, the mysterious miniature castle. We want to know who built this and why. Why would somebody take each little brick and put it together?
Spend a lot of time out here to do that. It doesn't come out of a mold.
No, although there is some mold on it.
That's moss.
Oh. I think it's the Lost Tower of Babel.
Wall of Jericho.
Do you think it's the Statue of Liberty 2,000 years from now?
You blew it up! Damn you!
Well, Mark was the first one to find this site. I think he was out roaming in the Meadowlands somewhere, weren't you?
I was just walking to the shore of the Hudson, I found this much more interesting than what I was originally looking for.
Are there a lot of these paths around here?
Yeah, they wind their way all throughout this area. The thing is about this area, it's undeveloped part of the park, so you won't find this mentioned anywhere in any park literature or pamphlets or nature walks or anything. And anybody that I've talked to has no explanation of it, so.
Obviously somebody was here because there's a cigarette butt right in the middle of it.
I thought that was yours from last week.
No.
You know, I think it's interesting is that they designed it as a ruin, you know. They didn't design it as a completed castle. They designed it as a falling apart castle, you know. These bricks were intentionally strewn around.
Very strange.
I don't seem to be any clues. And don't bother asking at the visitor center, because either they won't tell you or they don't know. Somebody has to. Somebody spends a lot of time out here in the swamp, you know, nailing those little bricks down.
And I wonder what else you can find out here.
That's the thing about Weird New Jersey. You never know what you're going to find if you walk down some unmarked trail.
Well, we've heard tales of alligators out here, too.
Oh, they're here.
Traveling through the state of New Jersey, the most beautiful state you wanna see. Traveling through the state of New Jersey, the garden state beside the sea.
Well, we are standing outside the building that was formerly known as the Palace Chop House and Tavern. This is the building that Dutch Schultz, the famous mobster, made his headquarters of operations. This is also the spot where he was killed. In 1935, Charlie Lucky Luciano and Meyer Lansky sent Murder, Inc., corporation of hitmen over here to rub out Dutch because he had threatened to kill the Manhattan prosecutor at the time, who was Thomas E. Dewey, future presidential candidate. And they didn't like the idea of the repercussions that that would cause in a otherwise, what they were trying to keep a low-key operation. So they came over here and went into the back room where Dutch and a couple of his bodyguards and his accountants had just had dinner and were sitting around, and they strolled in and did them all in.
Now, on the Weird New Jersey tour, we're standing out in front of the bathroom which Dutch Schultz got shot in. And we discovered that the local gangsters of the town have paid their homage to Dutch. C-D-U-C-T-A.
Spelling is a little, is not very good. But what it says is Dutch S inside. And this is where he was in 1935. You gotta think of what the odds are of, considering cement only stays wet for, you know, what, an hour? What are the odds of somebody not only knowing that this is the building where Dutch Schultz got shot and the room where he got shot, but being here when the cement was wet to inscribe this message here? That's pretty coincidental, don't you think? It's pretty weird.
Yeah.
What is this? Does that say it?
It G.
It G. Duck. 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 I think that they had so much trouble spelling Dutch that they just figured Schultz was out of their league. It's got T's and Z's in it.
Homage to the Dutchman. I'm going to find these things on state tourist map.
New Jersey, you're my home. New Jersey. See the train?
We're gonna go see Wavin' Joe. Wavin' Joe of Totowo.
What's so interesting about Wavin' Joe?
Well, the township of Totowo doesn't want him to wave because the neighbors are complaining that it causes people staying up late at night. People will ride down the middle of the street honking their horns. And it got so bad that they actually had to put up a sign saying, wave to your neighbors, but please don't honk. He's a great guy. One of New Jersey's finest.
Hi.
Hi, Joe.
Hi.
Joe, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself? How long you been out here waving?
Hi.
You doing good?
Hi.
Okay, keep waving.
Hi.
The police, they gave you some problems a while back, didn't
yeah.
they?
Well,
what did they, did they try to get you to stop waving?
Well, the judge told me not to wave.
Since when is it a crime to just wave?
I don't know. You got to see the judge about that.
It doesn't stop you, though, right?
No, because it'll be a $650 fine, which I don't have, and I'll go to jail.
They're going to charge you $650 if you wave?
Yeah, and I'll go to jail. They'll tell them I don't have it, so I'll go to jail. So I make the judge happy.
At the old bar, soak up the suds of the local swill and hear every lowdown story. Here comes an old story right now. Hello, Tom.
How are you, honey? And beer?
Yes, sir.
Tell us the story, Tom.
Well, no, we ain't going through that.
Come on. No, just one more time. Just hang on.
What happened? Oh, this happened back in I'd say early 60s. Two gentlemen used to come in and fight over this seat. They always sat in that seat. If they couldn't sit in that seat, they didn't come in here.
Why that seat?
And, well, they just liked that seat because at that time we didn't have the shade. And they used to sit there and read their paper after they retired. They'd sit there, and if somebody else was sitting in that seat, they wouldn't come in. They'd sit outside in the car and wait. And they both died within 30 days of each other. The bartender just happened to say, well, that's the death seat. Don't sit there. If you're over 65, nobody sits in that seat.
So you say old folks don't sit in that seat?
Old folks don't sit in that seat.
You let the young folks?
The young folks sitting there, we don't tell them the story. We changed all the stools in here except one.
Would you sit in there? How old are you now?
I'm 55.
So your time...
And that's the truth.
So your years of sitting in that seat are almost...
I'm pretty close, yeah. I have sat in that seat, though. But the bartender that named it the death seat, he came home from the track, had something to eat, and died in bed. A year later, his wife went to the track on a bus ride and died at the track. So, I mean, it's...
Oh, that's the story about the bartender.
Yeah. It's very funny.
I'm from New Jersey and I'm proud about it. I love the Garden State. I'm from New Jersey and I brag about it. I think it's simply great. All of the others...
Today we're in Laurel Grove Cemetery in Totowa. And we're here at the monument to the world's greatest electrician. And we're fortunate enough to have the designer of the stone, Lori Giordano, and Mr. Tony from Skoboda.
Skobas.
Nobody can pronounce Italian names.
So, Lori, can you tell us a little bit about this this stone here?
Well, my father was an electrician who really loved his work. And being that he wasn't the most religious person in the world and that I am an artist, I decided that a religious icon wasn't really suitable enough for him. So we decided to go with something more characteristic of him and his personality. Basically, what I did when I had the inspiration was I found this laying in the sand in Seaside Heights, New Jersey.
So would you say a light bulb went off over your head when you got the idea?
And I went to Anthony with this thing, and I said, can you make this 4 feet tall? He's like, sure.
Yeah, it was.
How long does something like this take to get done?
This took us almost 1 year. It's from one big block of granite. It is also 23-karat gold leaf on there.
Hmm. Oh, don't tell anybody that. They'll come and chip it off.
Now, does that plug work on the bottom?
No, it doesn't light up.
My father went to Passaic Technical High School, and he studied electricity because he knew his destiny right from the start. Here he is with a light bulb over his head.
Looks like a pretty motley crew.
Yeah, well.
So, do you think there's going to be a more of a trend toward representation in tombstones in the future?
I do. I really do, because people are somewhat moving away from the church, and they're moving into putting up memorials that represents their life and their lifestyle.
Right.
So you're going to see more types, maybe not another light bulb, but more different types of memorials certainly coming in the years to come.
My Garden State, you stand for everything that's great, and with a smile
see a simple storm drain here, but we're here with Weird New Jersey correspondent Ralph Sinisi.
How you doing there?
And he's going to tell us the story of the Gates of Hell, which this place is more commonly known as in local lore. Why don't you walk us through the Gates of Hell and...
Well, welcome everybody to the Gates of Hell, a very eerie, drab place that is rumored to have many levels which are now quite untravelable due to increased water flow, with rooms ranging from rooms with large axes on the doors to rooms filled with skulls, skeletons, and various other objects. Bones have been found here from animal sacrifices. It's filled with Satanist graffiti. Other rumors of levels, secret levels with candlelit rooms. It's just a very eerie place in general. I've heard about this place since I was a very young grammar school child. Kids have just been always scared to come here because they knew exactly what was going on here. You know, nobody wanted to actually, you know, admit to it. Just a pure feeling of evil. Truthfully, most people who come down here don't ever want to come back. They make it halfway through, and something inside them makes them turn back and run out towards the light.
Have you ever run into anybody else down here that maybe you didn't really want to get to know?
Fortunately, nobody ever face to face. But one time I can recall that we came down here and we were about to enter the tunnel and we heard screams from deep within the tunnel. And before I knew it, my friends were straight up the wall and already back up to the train tracks.
Well, thank you very much, Ralph. Oh. We really appreciate you coming down and braving the gates of hell with us.
Thank you. Thank you for coming with me to the gates of hell. I'm here by yourself, because you might get killed.
Okay, we're in Pete Katsos's hearse right now. And Pete, why don't you tell us where you're taking us?
Okay, we're going to Demon's Alley right now. It's an abandoned neighborhood. Years ago, it used to be like any other neighborhood. All of a sudden, everybody just got up and took off. And nobody knows why. They left all their stuff behind. In some cases, they left food on the table. So it's a real spooky place. The legend is, you know, it's really, really weird.
Demon's Alley. These are our tour guides right here. We got Mr. Rags, Mr. Pete, and Justin.
Right on.
So why don't you tell us a little bit about this place?
All right. The story goes, years ago, this was a regular neighborhood like anybody else's, like yours or mine, and one day, everybody got up and they took off. Some people left their food on the table, some personal belongings, furniture, all sorts of stuff. Just laying around like they were planning on coming back sometime, but nobody ever did.
Is it true that you've heard, or maybe you or yourself have gone into some of these buildings?
Oh. Well, yeah, depending on, you know, which law enforcement group you work for. But, yeah, that stuff is all true. There's stuff all over the place. TVs are the part that gets me the most. Who would leave a television set?
And wasn't there some rumors of murders in these houses?
There's all sorts of rumors all over the area. If you ask around, people will tell you some crazy stuff. People disappearing around here and all sorts of wacko stuff.
You have a story to tell about Demon's Alley, don't you?
Yes, actually I do, Mark. It was, actually, it's recounted from one of my friends who's a photographer who went to Demon's Alley to shoot a couple of flicks of some of the houses. He had taken pictures of all the houses separately, and the one house, the shutter, had some problem with it and it would not open, and every picture became
the shutter of the camera.
Yes, only on the one house, and it worked fine on the other houses. And he was, being an experienced photographer, he was quite perplexed by this. So he ventured into the town below Demon's Alley, and an old man accounted him a story of some kind of murderous plot which took place by a cult member. The old man said that a man had secretly had moved into the town, not letting anyone know of his past, and it had turned out that he was the head of a large cult in one of the Midwestern countries. And throughout his...
States, you mean, like Midwestern states?
Yep, that's what I meant. And throughout his stay there, weird goings-on started happening. Dead animals would be found, and people would be coming in and vandalizing homes. It got to a point where it was unbearable. And what the people did was they had town meetings. And they got together in this cult leader's house to discuss the goings-on in the town.
They didn't know that he was a cult leader?
No, they had no idea at the time. He just seemed like an everyday member of the society. And they all gathered into his living room, and upstairs in the house he had other members of the cult who, as soon as the meeting was ready to begin and everyone from the town had gathered, they committed a mass murder of everyone in the small town of, you know, about 5 or 6 houses. You know, the old man just said that the town wants to try to forget about it, and that, you know, it's not a well-known thing because they just try to put it behind them and move on.
We've heard them all, from animal sacrifice to, I don't even know.
Did you ever hear the story of the cult murders that took place up here?
No, I haven't heard that one, actually. Sorry.
That's a ride through my imagination. Today we're here in Clifton, New Jersey with Hoop, King of Art. That is it. I'm the self-proclaimed King of Art. The problem is that there's no figurehead for the art world, and I've decided to step into the throne room of the art world and become King of Art. How do the neighbors feel about the Hoop collection? Oh, they love the extra added bit of my public art. This is what I call public art. I have my art for the galleries, which is lately I collect celebrity fingerprints, enlarge them, and make them into artwork. Now this is the Captain Kangaroo's fingerprint. This is the original Captain Kangaroo.
The only true Captain Kangaroo.
Yeah, the real Captain Kangaroo, done in a variety of colors.
Hoop, how did you get Captain Kangaroo's fingerprint?
Oh, I generally meet a lot of celebrities at parties and just various public appearances. Here's Captain Kangaroo, Yoko, the late, great Tiny Tim, Eddie Munster, Gorbachev, Bill Buggs, Joan Jett, Famous Amos Cookie Man, Warhol Superstar Viva. This is an appearance I made on MTV, The Real World, and Cousin Brucey.
Weird New Jersey is interested in the way people express themselves, this particular site, in the way that they express themselves from beyond the grave. Ray's older brother David, who was a successful New Jersey businessman, had always promised Ray that on his 17th birthday he would give him a Mercedes-Benz. Unfortunately, Raymond died just before his 17th birthday. But David made good on his promise to give his younger brother a Mercedes, and this is what he gave him.
I think it's important to point out the workmanship here. It's astonishing. The grill work.
They must have got the specs from Mercedes.
I would imagine so. It seems to be built to a perfect scale. You see the tread in the tires.
And it's not a two-door model either.
No, this is a four-door stretch sedan. See the hubcaps, door locks.
Exhaust pipe.
Retractable antenna.
240D, popular model.
Diesel. So it does idle a little rough, but I can't be sure, but I bet those windows would have been tinted.
Well, come on, let's ride.
Elvis, left the building.
Hey, Ed.
Perfect timing.
Are you going to be performing today?
Huh?
You going to rock and roll for us today?
Well, I ain't going to swim, but...
How you doing, Dolores?
Okay.
Beautiful outfit.
Thank you.
Is proudly presents the Elvis Presley Show, starring live in concert, Elvis impersonator Edward Gale, with backup singer Andy. It's the sound of Elvis that you remember.
Hey,
I don't know. I regard Elvis Presley like he's part of my family. A lot of people would look at me and they say, well, hell, excuse me, I'm sorry. They say that, well, he can't be dead. There he is. And yeah. I'm not the man. I mean, I this collar is killing me. I try. When you think you're going to win, you think she's giving in. The stranger's on your side. I pay tribute to the man. I don't, Dolores, is this color right? It's really hard work, but I try to, you know, really, like, bring the image back. I like the guy because he's kind, given. He gave to the rich instead of thinking about himself. I mean, he gave to the poor. He gave to the poor. I want to try and get some place where I can have a museum, really, where I can show all this here stuff to the kids, let people see what the man was about. Mm-hmm. And I got more on him than I ever have on my life. I mean, I feel that, you know, his legend is going to go on going after him.
Well, you're doing your best to keep it alive out here, and all these people, I'm sure, would love to see you get back to the mic, so I'm not going to take up too much of your time.
The thing is, what I'm trying to do here is, I'm trying to...
Well, folks, that's our show. Hope that you enjoyed the tour. Before you disembark, don't forget to visit our souvenir shop. We have issues of the magazine available for purchase, as well as t-shirts in both black and white designs, bumper stickers to let everyone on the road know that you're on a Weird NJ tour, and even a CD featuring 17 of New Jersey's finest recording artists performing songs about our wondrous state.
The New Jersey Devil's got swaying wings.
Thanks for joining us, everybody. Stay weird.
The New Jersey Devil is really cool. The New Jersey Devil, he's got nasty hooves. The New Jersey Devil, he's got my soul. The New Jersey Devil, he can rock and roll.
Nothing else interests me quite like Weird New Jersey. No magazine can entertain my hours quite as well.
This is our New Jersey.
Yeah. Nobody else wants it.